Some of you know me, and for those that don't know me, my name is Larry Sornsen. I've been a husband for 53 years to the same person. I am a father of three, a grandfather of eight, a follower of Jesus Christ, and I try to be a servant of all. That's my goal in life. Because as the story unfolds, you'll understand why I am the way I am. Because of all the gifts that were given to me over the last 30 years of my life. But that wasn't always the case for me. I want to go back and start from the beginning again, because Larry wasn't always like the Larry is today. I kind of like the Larry is today. I really do. I feel better every night I go to sleep, and I get up in the morning and look forward to the day. But I'm going to tell a story first before I get into that about these two old guys that... These two old guys loved baseball. Steve and Scotty were their names, and they loved baseball. They were, from the time they were little kids, they grew up watching baseball. They played baseball. They weren't good enough to play pro, but throughout their whole life, they went to baseball games. They were inseparable. And yeah, pretty soon they fell in love with a couple of girls, got married, and they still stayed in this baseball camp. Baseball every day. Every day they loved it. Couldn't get enough. Well, they're getting up in their years now. They're getting pretty close to 80. And Stevie turns to Scotty and he says, "Hey, Scotty," he says, "I don't think it's going to be too long, and I'm going to be going up to be spend some time with the Lord." And Scotty says, "Gosh, Stevie, I'm going to really miss you." And he says, "But would you do me a favor?" He says, "When you get there, will you check it out and see if they have baseball up there?" Steve says, "Sure, I can do that for you." Wasn't even 2 weeks and Steve dies. He passes on, goes up to heaven, he scouts out the whole area, sends his spirit down, and looks up Scotty. He says, "Scotty," he says, "yeah, I got some good news and bad news." You know, Scotty always wants the good news first, that's the way Scotty is, And so Steve says, "Yeah, we got baseball 24 hours a day. It never gets dark up there. There's more baseball than you could ever want." Oh, he's all excited. He says, "Well, it could be the bad news." He says, "You're pitching Tuesday." I love telling that story, but when you really think about it, who wouldn't want to know today that you're pitching Tuesday in heaven? Mm-hmm. Really, some say, "Oh gosh, that's not nice," but it is nice, So I always like to tell, it's kind of a nice little story. I love telling my story because it's not my story. It's a story of Jesus Christ and how he works in my life and the life of so many. He took me from being lost to give me a life in him, and I cherish that. And as the story unfolds, you understand even more so why I feel the way I am and why I do what I do, because of the opportunities that's been presented to me over the years. I'm 75 years old. I will be the 19th of May. Address, give my address so they can send me cards and stuff. But, I think about my life over the last 30 years and what God's done to my life. It's been miraculous. It's just that he could take somebody like me and do what he did with me. I label this talk as an urgency type talk, and as it unfolds, I hope you understand why I'm saying this. And this is why I'm so adamant about my being a servant and sharing the love of Christ with everybody, because we are in an urgency mode. We're not promised tomorrow, guys, you know that. So, I grew up in a loving family. I have a twin brother, I have an older brother, I have a sister. And we were sent to Sunday school, went to confirmation, got all the information I needed about Jesus, and I quit going to church. I mean, I graduated, right? Isn't that what we all do after we get through a confirmation? We stop going and, I knew it all, so what else? Why else would I do that? Continued on, got into high school, graduated from high school, went into the service where I was in the reserves, but did my time in there and got out, found a job. And I looked up this old girl from school. Actually, she wasn't my girlfriend. She wouldn't date me in high school for some reason or not. I couldn't understand that. But we fell in love, got married, and we had some kids. Well, I was from lower northeast Minneapolis, and lower northeast Minneapolis is the melting pot for the, it seemed like from Minnesota, every ethnic group from from Europe was there. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Swedes, Norwegians, Polacks, Syrians, Italians, you name it. They all came into this area here, and they all had their little communities all around, maybe, you know, 4, 5, 8, 10 blocks of Polacks, and they all had their own churches, and they all had their own bars, too, you know, because that's where they got together, you know. So I always like to say there was a bar and a church on every corner in Northeast. A little exaggeration, but it seemed like that, especially when I used to hang out in a lot of those, you know. But it was kind of a nice neighborhood. But this gal I married, I lived in Lower Northeast, and that's where the blue-collar people were, and the white-collar were up on the hill. See, and they had a little more money, little nicer homes, and so forth. And I kind of felt I got kind of lucky. I got this white-collar gal, you know. So we're married, and I thought, well, maybe I should start going to church again. So we started going to church, and Mom and Dad belonged to the same church. Brother-in-law was a pastor. He ended up being assistant to the bishop. Matter of fact, he helped start this church here. Did the first service here. Told me about it, but that's later on in the story. So anyways, I would go to church every Sunday with my wife. Felt good. Dressed up. Oh, I love this. I dressed up in a nice suit, because back then you wore a suit, a tie, and shiny shoes. And I knew all the songs. I knew all the liturgy. Man, I looked good. I mean, I was one of them. Until I got home that afternoon and pull out a six-pack of beer, watch some football, and drink some beer, you know? Back to the old Larry. See, I wanted to hang on a little bit of the old Larry and still capture some of the new Larry with my wife and that. So I went to church for all the wrong reasons, for my wife, her family, and my brother-in-law, the pastor, and sister-in-law. And I looked good. Now I'm in my 30s, and I'm thinking, you know, just drinking beer and hanging out in saloons once in a while isn't all that's cracked up to be. I got sick and tired of not feeling good and in the mornings, you know, so I thought, well, I'm going to do something. But in this time, see, I put God up here on that shelf over there, you know. I was really busy for God, and I thought, well, I'll set him up there, and when I get into my 50s, I'll be right. I'll have time to, you know, I'll slow down a little bit. I'm not doing all these things, fishing and all this kind of stuff. So I kept him on a shelf. So I didn't really know him, but I knew of him. So anyways, I called him down. And I says, hey, you know, I was on my knees. I even knew enough to pray on my knees. I got on my knees. I said, you know, I'm sick and tired of this beer drinking, Lord. I want you to help me get rid of it. That was in 1980. I haven't had a beer since. But I was still smoking cigarettes, which is a part of my health issue that I have. I was smoking 2 or 3 packs a day, and I had to have some kind of vice, right? I quit drinking, so I mean, you know, hang on to this baby a little bit. So pretty soon I got sick and tired of drinking, or of smoking, and gosh, you see me in the morning, I get up and I go to the bathroom, I start coughing and gagging, getting all that crap out of my lungs. I settled there overnight, you know, and as soon as I got that up, I'd light a cigarette. And then I'd start coughing and gagging, and some of my the people I did work for, that I sold labor, I put their products in, I'd say, I'd have to call you back. They call me, I'd start gagging, I'd go to the bathroom and start gagging. I said, gosh, my kids were getting sick, and I'm thinking, you've got to quit this stuff. This is too hard on your body, you know. Plus, I inhaled sawdust all my life, you know. So you take the combination of the two, it did its toll on my body. So I pulled this Jesus back down there off that shelf, and I says, Lord, I'm on my knees. I says, I'm sick of the cigarette smoking. I've quit probably 100 times. It's not worked. I need your help. Within 2 weeks, I never had an urge to smoke, and I haven't smoked since. Big deal. I get a little emotional with this. They didn't have patches, Nancy. And, you know, if you're on a 2 to 3 pack of cigarettes a day, that's a big habit. And they, some say it's probably as bad as drugs, because it's something you do more often. First thing in the morning, I'm taking a leak, I'm smoking a cigarette. And the last thing I do is, same thing, go to the bathroom and throw the cigarette butt in the toilet, you know. So it was constantly, the house was always filled with smoke. But God took me off of that. I mean, you know, you hear about people now using patches and so forth, but all I can say is if you're a cigarette smoker, give it up. you need help, call on Christ. If you have a problem with alcohol, call on Christ. Don't try to do it yourself. You can't do it by yourself. I tried it. It didn't work. During that time I was self-employed, I had been running a company for quite a few years. I got out of that, but it was that the stress was too severe, and so I went into business for myself. I installed other people's products, kitchens basically. Making lots of money, I enjoyed my work. I was my own boss, and things were good. My wife was a stay-at-home mom. We decided her to do that. Back then you could get away with that, with only one person working. It's a sacrifice, but she was a school teacher and she decided to stay home for 20 years to make sure our kids were raised properly. And we're doing all kinds of fun stuff. We're making a lot of money and I have all this stuff, boats, new cars, and all this kind of stuff, making all, living a good life, but I wasn't going to church. I kept God up on that shelf. I put him back up on that shelf because until I got into my 50s, so I'm fine with that. My wife would make sure the kids got to Sunday school and she would go to church. And I, you know, because I'd working so hard, that Sunday was my day off where I could rest because I worked, you know, 5.5 days a week a lot of times. And so I kept God up there where I thought he belonged. I'd go to church a few times a year and to, you know, that C&E church and to appease my wife, I went for her still, you know, so I'd look good once in a while. I didn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and that was something I didn't really know was missing in my life, because if I'd had it ahead of time, I would have probably understood and stayed with it, but I didn't realize what it was like to have him in my life. My family was enjoying life. We spent a lot of time together on weekends, fishing, hunting. I coached hockey for 7 years, got involved in that with my kids. I was always kid-oriented with my family, did a lot of things except I didn't go to church with my kids. The worst thing I could have done is not go to church with my kids, because the dad is the one who helps formulate their children into those habits and that it's okay. My kids would see that I wasn't going to church. They didn't want to go to church, but I made them go. What kind of example did I set? Crummy example. But then, on December 14th, I never forgot the date, 1983. Working in a big apartment building, you know, where the bridge collapsed downtown. As you come into downtown from northeast Minneapolis, there's a big apartment building on the left-hand side. That was a project I'd been working on for 3 months. I was like a machine. You turn the key and I would go in there and I'd pop out many. I'd make a lot of money back then, working my tail off. Stopped and had morning coffee with all the guys at construction down below. I got back up and went into this room. I'm on a room by myself, on a floor by myself. And went back and started working right after coffee break, started getting this chest pain, and the first thing I thought of, man, yeah, I weighed 185 pounds, I had six-pack abs, and I had rocks like this, my chest was all, you know, top shape, quit smoking, quit drinking before that. I'm 43 years old, what could be wrong? The sandwich I just ate, heartburn, had to be, right? What else could it be? So I continued to work, and starting to get a little chest pain or headaches and getting sweaty, so I tried to open up one of the windows. And new construction, if you guys have ever done that, especially in the wintertime, it was like below zero. And tried to open a window, and there's so much humidity, it was froze shut, so I couldn't crack the window. So I thought, well, I'll just sit on my toolbox so the paint leaves. The pain got worse. Pretty soon it went down my left arm. Heart attack. So now I'm in a room by myself, on a floor by myself, and the only elevator that you can use is at the other end of the building, which is almost a block away. And I knew if I fell over in this room, nobody would find me until my wife reported me not coming home from work in the evening. So I thought I better start this journey down there. And I, hanging onto the wall as I'm going down, slow steps, I didn't want to go fast, for the simple reason that, you know, it caused more problems with my heart. So So I'm walking down there, finally get to the elevator, and the elevators, normally you have a 25, 45 minute wait for elevators because they're hauling all materials up. This is under construction. So I mean, if somebody's got a floor of cabinets, they're hauling them up and down, you know, spotting them and so forth. I walk up to the elevator, I'm going to push the button, the door opens. And this gal, I remember her name, Vicky, this is a good memory. I mean, this is so real, like it was just yesterday. I said, "Vicky, I'm having a heart attack." I must have been pretty pale. And she said, "Well, sit down." And there was a roll of carpet laying there that they just hauled up the carpet, the floors. I'm sitting on that roll of carpet, and she called on her walkie-talkie, got the job suit to run up a flight of stairs. And I'm sitting there thinking, I said, "This has got to be a dream." You ever have a bad dream, you know, and you wake up and you say, "Oh, man, am I glad." It wasn't a dream. How can this be? So the ambulance came. Gosh, it wasn't even 3 or 4 minutes. It seemed like anyways, it was really quick. And they gave me, put a shunt in my neck and gave me some medicine in there to take care of it, stabilized me. And they said, "Well, where would you like to go to the hospital?" And I says, "Well, I live in Fridley. I'm 3 minutes from a hospital down there. I'm more worried about my wife. I never had a heart attack. I don't know how bad they are. So I'm waiting. I went worried about my wife coming down to see me and she'd get lost and all that kind of stuff. I said, "Take me to Fridley. We live in Fridley." Threw me in an ambulance and we start to cross that bridge that collapsed. I started to pray to this God. I took him off the shelf and brought him in there in that ambulance with me. I says, "Lord, you got to help me. Help me get through this." And I'm listening to the paramedic as we're going across the bridge, giving him my vital signs of the hospital. He's got me all hooked up to a bunch of stuff. Saying, "Well, we're on the intersection of 35W and University, you know where that is? Going toward for the 35W and 4th Street." And he says, "Oh, we're on 35 and, ah, shit." Well, that's the last thing you want to hear when you're praying and you're having a heart attack. I looked up and that machine that was going like this was now straight line. Scared. I was scared to death. Guys, I wasn't worried about dying. I was worried about where I was going to end up. I took God out of my life until I got good and ready for him. The scripture talks, says, "If you don't know me, I won't recognize you when I come back." I knew a lot of that stuff, but I didn't own it. I was worried about going to hell. And I've given this talk in Sandstone Prison before, and over 100 and some guys there, and they're in tears in this talk. They got arms the size of my waist. And they're all crying over this, you know. And I said, "I'd rather fight all of you guys at the same time than be that afraid again, because it was my salvation I was concerned about. If you don't think that's big, you better start thinking about it now." I was sure in my heart I was going to go to hell. They get me to the hospital, and it's kind of ironic, they put me in the emergency room. They were ready for me, man alive, boom, boom, out of that ambulance. And I looked up, and there's my doctor. My family doctor is on duty. That's what they did back then. And that was kind of nice. And I'm telling them the story, and I'm talking about what the paramedic said. And the paramedic was behind me. I had no clue, and he apologized for swearing. I says, "That's the last thing I want to hear is that your story, because you got me here. Don't even worry about it." I was thankful for that. So they put me in ICU for 4 days. I have basically every machine that I thought the hospital had hooked up to me, not knowing if I was going to live or die. So I had a lot of time to ponder my relationships, what was important. All my stuff, my boat, my house, my car, my truck, all of that could be taken from me in a twinkling of an eye. The stuff I worked so hard for. My bank account could all be gone. My family. What was important? The stuff was worth nothing. Nothing. I put my value in the wrong things. My relationship with Jesus Christ, what we developed while I was laying in that room, that ICU room, for 4 days, I got to thinking about what kind of what was important to me. My family was so important to me now, because that's going to be gone. The things meant nothing. But my relationship with Jesus Christ ended up being the most important thing, and still is to this day. So I made a deal with God. I said, Lord, if you allow me to survive this heart attack, I will turn my life over to you. And I meant it. I meant it. So that's part reason why I do what I do. I kept my part of the bargain, and he kept his part of the bargain tenfold. That story is just like it was yesterday. Yeah, and that's why I normally don't need any notes for that story. And it's still blazing in me. Shortly after leaving ICU, they put me in a bed for another 3 days. And they said I'd be a while till my heart got strong enough to take a stress test. That was 8 weeks before they could put me on a stress test machine. But during that time, I asked him if it would be okay to go to hockey games. I had a son that was a goalie and a son that was a forward. And he says, well, you don't get excited at hockey games, do you? Lied through my teeth. During one of those games, my son caught a puck in the throat. And they had to haul him off to the hospital. And that was in Minnetonka. And I thought I was going to have another heart attack during that time. But he survived. I survived. But I failed the stress test right away, and they said you need an angiogram. So I went down to hospital. It used to be Metropolitan Hospital. It used to be down by General Hospital there, and they found out that I had some blocked arteries. Not too bad. 2 100% blocked, an 80 and a 60. You say, this God of ours is so fantastic. When the blockage is here, the blood vessels grow around that, collateral circulation, they call it. So I was getting just enough blood to keep the heart muscle working, but under stress it wouldn't work. My doctor told me 80% contributing factor of my heart disease was cigarette smoking. You smoke, give it up. They did a quad bypass on me. But the night before they did that, I remember this pastor, my neighbor next door, before I went in for the surgery, she had my wife and I and family over for dinner, and she had called the pastor at the C&E church I went to and said, well, Larry's doing this, would you want to come down and give him communion? He called and asked, and I said, I'd love that. We're in this room, the family's all around, we're all having communion with them, and guys, when I received the communion, I felt the Holy Spirit come over me in such a way that took away all fear from what was going to happen. The next morning, they're going to cut my chest open. They're going to pull my heart out and work on it. And I had no fear. I laid there in that bed that night after everybody left thinking about what a peace I had, and I thought, how many people are just like me in that same situation, going to have some serious surgery that they might not come out of? And they're worried, is this it if I die? I knew I wasn't going to die. I was going to go to heaven if I died, and if I didn't, that was fine too. I had all the peace in the world. So they came and got me in the morning. The family walked the gurney down to the surgery room, and the nurses did the final prep on me, and they looked at me, and they said, you don't seem to be too concerned. They cover your whole body, and this is when they used to shave your whole body for something like that. I mean, every part of your body was shaved, and they cover you with all this disinfectant stuff, you know. And they said, you don't seem to be too concerned. And I says, well, no, I'm not. I said, if I die and go to heaven, that's a win situation, and if I survive, it's a win situation. That was a pretty good feeling to have. Well, as you can see, I survived that surgery.
Your hair grew back.
Yeah, and I'll tell you, it was an experience that I wouldn't wish on anybody, but since then I had another bypass surgery. I had 29 stents in my body. I've had both my carotids cut out and replaced. I been cut from my groin to my knee to have my main arteries and my legs cut lengthwise and scraped down. I'm telling you this because of the miracle that God's done in my life. The rest of the story's coming now because, you know, I think about taking God and putting him out of my life and then what he could do with me and what he's done with me. And if you think God can't use you, you're limiting this God that we love and we worship and praise. God can do anything he wants with you if you allow him to do these things. Sometimes it takes something tragic like this in our lives to get our attention. What will it be yours if you don't have that connection? I will tell you, nothing is more important than your relationship with Jesus Christ. Nothing. Not even your family. You need to have that connection with Jesus Christ. And guys, he's waiting for you. If you don't have it, take it, set that up, absorb it. Like I said, you're not promised tomorrow. You're not even promised to get home here today. You're not promised another breath. I can tell you, I know all about that stuff. This is a Jesus-type success story. What he can do in your life. And, you know, like I say, all these things that he's done for me over all these years. I want to give you a couple of verses here that, you know, it's kind of ironic. On Tuesdays, there's a few of us lay people that come in and with the pastors and staff, and we give input to the sermons that are coming up with the 2 weeks afterwards. And this is from Colossians 3. This was last Tuesday's. And I'm reading this and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, does this tie in with this story? So I'm going to read this quickly to you guys. Chapter 3, verse 1. Then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, for Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is now hidden in Christ, with Christ, in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk and wait in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must rid yourself of such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with the practices, and you have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge in the image of the Creator. Here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all, and Christ is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience. Bear each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Guys, this is what you do. You get rid of the old self. The old self. I'm not the old Larry. I'm not. I get pretty emotional about that because I thought the old Larry was good until I found a new Larry. Sometimes we think what we're doing is okay, but it's not. If you're not connected to Jesus Christ, do yourself a great service. Get attached. I always like that umbilical cord to me all the time, 24 hours a day. From the morning I get up, I start with my prayer, I connect God with God all throughout my day. In the evening, I can't close my day without having a conversation with my Savior. I'm still a work in progress, and I will be till the day he calls me home, and so will you. Don't expect miracles overnight. It took me 30-some years to get to this point after I turned my life over to Christ. I'm excited about what God has in store for me, and I'm excited what God has in store for you. We all have an opportunity to make a difference in our communities. That's why this group is gathered. Take that. But start in your family first. Start at home. Let it permeate out of your homes, into your church, into your neighborhoods. God's waiting for you. Don't wait. Questions, comments, wonderings?
Thank you.
What a nice story. The glory goes to God. I take no credit for what I've done, because I wouldn't have done it without him.